Now, these After Effects techniques that I love fall into two categories, quick and quicker, so let's not mess about. If it fits the style, this can add a lot of extra movement and depth to your animation. These are made by creating four similar brush strokes with a textured brush in Photoshop, then looping them in After Effects so they change every four frames or so, and then applying them where the shadows or highlights might appear in your design, and using a matte or a mask to confine them to just that layer. Now, you'll have to do this a few times depending on your design, but good things come to those who... In the olden times, printers used to mess up sometimes, not like the reliable bastions of technology they are today. If I want a retro printed feel, I like to misalign the line art of an animation. First, we need to separate them. So we'll take our finished animation, add the extract effect, and drag the histogram over from the left to remove the dark colored line art and just leave the colors remaining. Then duplicate that layer with Ctrl or Command D, and then on that layer, adjust the histogram in the opposite direction to leave just the line art. Then we can select any of these layers and move its position about and misalign it as much or as little as we want. And some looping texture over the top for good measure too. Here's an animation I made with some fancy gradients, but I like the ball to really feel shiny and reflect the colors on the other layers. So we can do that by duplicating the layer we want to reflect, dragging that over closer to our object a little bit, and adding the set matte effect to it. Then we're going to take the matte from our circle layer and add a Gaussian blur, and we'll pump that up a fair bit. Now you can put the Gaussian blur above the set matte, and that creates an interesting, more stylized effect, but if you want it to look more realistic, we'll drag that below our set matte effect, and to remove the blur that is going on outside of the circle, we can just duplicate that set matte effect, again with Ctrl or Command D, and drag that below the Gaussian blur to restrict it just to that circle again. And now if we increase the blurriness and maybe just move the shape back a bit, we can see it isn't as visible on the very edges of our circle, which creates a nice realistic effect and looks like it's wrapping around a 3D sphere. Now you'll probably be fading things on and off a lot by keyframing its opacity, so let's spice it up by animating its color at the same time. So to do that, we will add a fill effect, and where that layer is transparent, let's keyframe its color, then move it along to where it is fully visible, and change that fill's color to white. So now it changes color as it fades on, and it's a little more interesting. That same spice pairs very well with gradients too. And I'll do this by adjusting our gradient fill. So instead of going from black to white or any other two colors, we'll add a new color in the middle, which would normally be a 50% gray, but we can make it a bit more interesting just by adding a slightly warmer gray into the mix. And you can do this as subtle as you want, and I think it works better the more colors there are. So we can even add a darker, cooler color to the darker gray and give the lighter gray a bit warmer. It won't work for every project, but if you want to add a tiny bit more life and color to your artwork that is barely perceptible, this is a great way to do it. Okay, we're halfway through. I hope you're finding these techniques helpful. If you're up for it, leaving a like really does help these videos and me out a lot. And if you're new to motion design and After Effects, for the last year, I've been creating the ultimate beginner's guide to motion design called Motion Foundation, which is coming out next month. That is all I can share at the moment, but please stay tuned for updates about that shortly. If you want to transition from a circle to a square or a rectangle, don't mess about editing the path and getting yourself all tied up in Bezier handles. Just create a new shape with the rectangle tool, open its rectangle properties, its path, and then animate its roundness. And you can go from circle to square seamlessly. Shake your animation around a bit. Not too much, like a camera shake, but like the subtle shake that I've been using on all of those titles. Now, I love this because it reminds me of legacy media, like a film spool not perfectly aligned or a tape head in a VHS. I'm not 100% sure why, but older stuff shakes around a little bit. So on a new adjustment layer on top of everything, we can add the transform effect and Alt or Option click the stopwatch next to position to enter in the wiggle expression. And we're gonna add in a frequency of 12 and an amplitude of 1, so that 12 times a second, it will randomly move one pixel in any direction. And we get a tiny subtle shake. We can see more if we zoom in. This will shake your layer away from the edges though, so let's increase the scale just by 1% to cancel that out. I also love the blooming highlights of film and old media that you can replicate by stacking some glows in After Effects, but they can very easily overpower the image and be kind of finicky to adjust using the threshold and the radius properties. and you can't always get a good result reliably very quickly. So what I like to do is add a glow effect to an adjustment layer on top of everything. We can keep the default glow. I'll duplicate it, increase the radius a little bit more, then duplicate it and increase the radius again. And I'm not worried about how ludicrously bright the image is. I'm just looking at how nice and realistic the fall off is, how the glow kind of dissipates. Then I like to add a curves effect over the top of all of those glows and then drag the brightness down so the glow is starting to look a little more like what I want. Now, if we toggle that adjustment layer on and off, we do see that it is losing a lot of the contrast of the image. So if we do want to keep that, we can change the blending mode of that adjustment layer to screen. So this is just adding glow on top. And now we can just adjust this curves effect to decide how bright our glow is and what the threshold is, which areas of our image, how bright it needs to be to glow. And I just find this a little more intuitive to adjust than trying to balance a handful of different properties across three different glow layers to tweak around. Now, putting eyes on anything instantly turns it into a character. Is this a cheap trick? Absolutely. Is it overused? Impossible. I use it because it creates a connection between the audience and the character. I mainly do it to get a bit of strangeness or humor to the scene. A pencil is a little bit interesting, but when it becomes a living thing and they're visibly loving it, it kind of makes you think, what kind of perverse sentience is happening within this universe? And that's the kind of question I think we should all be asking. Not everything has to be an optical sugar rush with flashing colors and shapes zipping around, hijacking your dopamine to keep you glued to your screen for that sweet, sweet engagement as our ability to focus shrivels up and turns into dust in the gutter. Now, I've animated plenty of work like that, and when I do, it's usually compensating for a lack of substance. Now I'm finding stillness more and more refreshing, and having that contrast will make your intense motion more impactful. Now, I love this 3-minute sequence from Ghost in the Shell. It doesn't move the plot forward, it's just establishing shots of the city setting the tone. Most of the shots have very subtle animation, and some are just stills. Of course, fantastic design, sound, and music help enormously with this. And obviously, in motion design, we're working to a brief where we often have to capture attention quickly. But it is helpful to remember that more animation isn't your only tool to make better animation.